Because you come up from the meeting more than that. Thank you, Nick. Why don't you come up and meet one of you guys who are here to trip? Here's the first time I have one of those set box that you can have and watch kids and stuff. And then you can come out here and you want to see the crazy. So there you are, you're here in the States, so we're here on the week. I've got to push you along. We are in the world, I've got to tell you a minute. How did you move from that to the U.S. Army? Well, I got from there, I went to Washington, D.C. because I didn't like kids, and I went down to visit my mom. I saw DCSA and then went to Brooklyn.
Okay.
So got there, decided I had to go back to high school. In 20 years, I celebrated my 20th birthday in America. So I went to, hopping from high school to high school. And then this one teacher said, listen, you hate what I'm going to do because I have these guys working here and having interesting education. My mom, no time off, she found herself in immigration problems. So went to the immigration with her. I said, I'm not speaking American. Most of it back to Sydney to go and my brother and sisters, but that's where we didn't work in the grounds of where I'm descending backwards. It's because of our family system. So I decided that it's better for me to leave school, leave college, volunteer for the army, get my mom straight so she could be able to run my brother and sisters and get it turned out to be the best thing, one of the best decisions.
So you got to have an army and you got a post in Hawaii. I competed twice about 1968.
I did it last night. I was signed to the IT, which is on my good development. And I was going to cover the guy naturally, and I was someone naturally better. I was trying to visit the South Village School Spy, which was on the good and I was going to cover his naturally, and I'm going to tell him some. But they were in my big lab, I waited right after that. Let's talk about your collaboration with Frankie Monty, because you did that very early in the piece after you finished in 1974. You did not see this in 1975. And then you started that collaboration with Frankie Monty. I started in 77. So that's the same as the truth, but then I ended up in Toronto as well. So it's life. After I went to Trinidad and became an advocate, I wanted to prove to
him that he was
the biggest I wanted to prove to people that I had the same traditional calypso, but I had already known that calypso as it was then didn't move much for me. That was one of the things I did in Hawaii, is sang the beats every Sunday. And I used to observe, I started to use it as an experiment, experiment with the audience to see what calypso sang. Every time I sing, they come to Harry when I talk to him. They say, oh, he's got a Harry. And when they never mention Sparrow to him, I felt that because of the, those are the two legends of the person. And so but I said, if I make a word, it's a traditional concept. Yeah. So I work in Harry. And in the process, because I have the family, after St. Vincent, I have an encounter with my son, Danny Winston. And he had written it in person. So I was big show in New York with a great one, but with Dana. Because these silicon reading music, they can say, I'm going to get on the boat with the US. So, one of the musicians in Berry's band is a gentleman from Bali, the Crimson Scrub. Well, who I know, I met earlier, he's a big matinee, because I sang out the matinee to find my radio. And he told me to find him.
That's the last one I know about, that's right. So, I want to go a little bit more, because we had done it in the first section, but still, when we come back, we pick up on that. The journey you started with Frankie Macintosh, and how that transformed Beckett and
transformed Calypso.
And Calypso. So we'll get that when we come back. This is our end of the line. My guest is the University of Calypso, Austin Bell Sellers.